सो नेक्स्ट रीडिंग इज फिनटेक इन इन्वेस्टमेंट मैनेजमेंट. इग्नोर दिस रीडिंग नंबर, दिस इज रॉन्ग. सो दिस इज दी दिस रीडिंग हैज बीन इंट्रोड्यूस्ड दिस ईयर ओनली. देर वॉज नो सच रीडिंग इन प्रीवियस ईयर्स. This reading has been included in level 1 as well as level 2 curriculum. In level 2, there are other readings are based on fintech as well, which have been included, but in level 1 only this reading has been included. And the reason is very obvious because this is one of the most recent concepts, or the use of fintech is increasing at a high pace. So before we start the reading, what is fintech? So fin means finance and tech means technology. If you combine fin finance and technology, that becomes fintech. So fintech is any type of technology in finance. What are the key developments? Key developments in fintech are big data, artificial intelligence, and machine learning. And this we will discuss that what is it actually and how is it, what developments are being done in these areas. Also, investment advisory services are undergoing changes with growth of automated wealth advisors. That wealth management is also becoming automated, and instead of now having human advisors, you are having machine advisors. Machine can advise you or manage your wealth, which is known as robo advisors. Apart from that, blockchain technology and distributive ledger technologies are creating ways to record, track, and store transactions. So previously, you need to have You used to have an analyst who would find out correlations and who would find out how what variables are related and how those variables can impact the future. And they used to predict future. Now this can very well be done by artificial intelligence or machine learning by using big data, and the predictions can be even better or more accurate. Previously, you used to have wealth managers who used to manage wealth or advise clients about their trades or about their wealth management. Now you have robo advisors to do that job. Previously, you used to have third party intermediaries which used to track the ownership, that who has bought the asset, who has sold the asset, and who has the asset. As of now, they used to track the ownership of the asset or transfer of asset from one to another party. But now with blockchain and distributive ledger technologies, those 3Ps or intermediaries are no more needed. So this is how technology is changing the landscape of finance, and all this falls under the domain of fintech, which is finance technology, finance and technology meeting. So what is fintech? We have discussed technological innovation and design and delivery of services and products of finance. Evolution. So starting with, initially we used to have automation. What was automation? So let's say if I am a human and I have a job to copy paste something, I can automate it and I can have a machine do it or robot do it for me. That is, it can copy and it can paste a file. That is simple automation or simple routine task automation. That is automating a routine task. If I have to do something again and again, I can automate it. I can write an algorithm and instruct machine to do it for me, and it can keep on doing it. If I have to switch on computer after every 1 hour, I can advise machine to do it. If I have to switch off something after 1 hour, I can advise machine to do it. That's how it is. So initially, it started with that kind of automation. Then it progressed with systems providing execution of decisions according to a specified rule and instruction. Then I started providing rules and instructions based on those system itself could take a decision. So instead of me taking a decision, I can give a set of rules and instruction that, for example, if PE is less than this, then sell. PE is greater than this, then sell, and so on. So system can itself take the decision. It progressed into system taking decision based on provided instructions and rules. And then it moved ahead and progressed further with decision making applications based on complex machine learning logic, where computers can learn how to complete tasks over time. So instead of you providing them rules and instructions, they can keep on learning themselves and keep on getting better and better and keep on taking, and then can eventually start taking decisions themselves without someone telling them to take a decision. So that's how this whole technology or evolution, fintech, has evolved and progressed. So, what are next question is that what are the areas where fintech is impacting the industry, or what are the areas which are directly relevant, where fintech is directly relevant to investment industry? They include analysis of large data set. So, if you have massive amounts of data, it becomes difficult to analyze it for a human. So, machines can do it for you and can take a decision by analyzing that data. Analytical tools, like for example, artificial intelligence, that is, they are now capable of having human intelligence. So, just like human can track behavior or sentiment, this artificial intelligence can help get insights related to human sentiment and behavior. Then, automated advice, like robo advisors that we just discussed, that is your personal wealth managers. Then financial, and these obviously as they are automated, they are providing the service at low cost. So robot advisors can manage your wealth at low cost compared to human. Financial record keeping, as we discussed, blockchains and distributed ledger technology is now reducing the need for intermediaries or third parties. They are able to keep a track of the asset ownerships, asset transfers in secured databases, and can give you a one version of truth. So, for example, a distributed ledger technology or blockchain can help you with tracking evidence. For example, there is a farmer which is farming and growing some ingredient and raw material. That ingredient is going to factory and being processed. That factory is selling it to some distributor. That distributor is selling it to some company. That company is making a product out of that ingredient, and then product is being used by consumer. Blockchain technology or distributed ledger technology can help track all of this. So consumer sitting here buying the product can enter a code into a system and can find out where does the raw material came from, who was the farmer, where in which land was it grown, what were the pesticides used, and then so on. So this is the futuristic state of it. That's how the future can look like, or that's how blockchain or distributive technology can help you track the information. Key drivers of fintech development are rapid growth in data and technological advances. So growth in data is making it difficult to analyze data, and so in order to analyze data you need machine, and then at the same time technological advances are enabling you to use machines to analyze that data, or enabling machines to analyze that data for you. So these two are the key drivers of fintech development. Any problem so far? So we discuss three main key developments: big data, AI, and machine learning. Now we will discuss these three one by one. So starting with big data, what is big data? Big data means vast amount of data being generated from traditional and alternate sources. What are traditional? Traditional are, for example, stock exchange, companies, governments, publications, and all that, the data which we have. Alternate is anything which is not traditional, like for example, electronic devices, social media, sensor networks, company exhaust. So there is so much of data around you, or so much of data which is being created, that this is such a large amount of data that it is becoming humanly impossible to analyze that data. That data is known as big data. That is all the data combined together. Anything and everything. What you speak, what you talk, what you post, what you like, what you dislike, what you email, what you have on your social media, what you are posting, everything and anything is included in big data. What apps you have on your phone and so on. Characteristics of big data. So volume is very huge, very large. There are millions and billions of data point, so it is humanly impossible to analyze them. Velocity, speed with which data is being communicated is extremely great. For example, it is real time, it is changing every moment, and every moment there is some new data point about everyone, or about the market, or about individual. And variety, that data is not coming in from one source, it is coming in from multiple sources, and there are so many sources from which it is coming in from. So it can be structured in terms of tables and CSV, like traditionally we used to have, or it can be unstructured. So it can be a video message, it can be a voice call, it can be a like, it can be a dislike, it can be anything. So it can be an image, even images have data in them. So it can be any form, it can be an unstructured form or any or every form, or it can be semi-structured, that is combination of these two. So data is volume is getting very large or is huge. Velocity is very fast or it has increased to almost real time, and variety, that there is different types of data. So these are three characteristics of big data. So if you have data which is huge in quantity, which is being updated every moment, which is in different types of varieties in different types of form, then obviously it becomes difficult to analyze that data. And all that data combined together is known as big data. That is data from each and every source with high velocity and different varieties. Volume, velocity and variety. So this tells you about velocity. It can be a batch, it can be periodic, it can be near real time, or it can be real time or beyond that. This is volume. It can be MB, it can be GB, it can be terabyte, it can be PB, and beyond that, the volume is just increasing and there is no end to it. With respect to a variety, it can be a table, it can be database, it can be photo, it can be web, it can be audio, it can be social media, it can be video, it can be unstructured, it can be a mobile phone data. So anything and everything is included. And this defines the big data. This whole data together is big data. Real time, yes, every second being updated every second or changing every moment. Yes, so it will need to be structured if you are using, if there is a human using it. But if there is a machine using it, it can convert into a usable form without putting it into a table. Everything cannot be put into a table. So you cannot put a video into a table or into a CSV file or Excel file or a spreadsheet. So that's how it is, that this is so much data that even some data cannot be moved into a table form or a spreadsheet form. So previously we used to convert everything into a spreadsheet or usable form, but now that cannot be done. So now you need to make use of unstructured data as well, because most of the data is being created in unstructured form. Where is it coming from? Data is coming from, it is coming from financial markets, businesses, governments, individuals, sensors, Internet of Things. Like for example, if you have a smart refrigerator, if you have a smart climate control, a smart air conditioner, everything and anything is generating data or is making or producing data. Sensors, traffic patterns, satellite imagery, your credit card purchases, your reviews that you write on internet, search logs, whatever you are searching for, everything is just is creating data. So these all are the places where data is coming from. And now all of this data is being used and this needs to be used. You cannot only rely on structured data or published or public data in order to, or publish data in order to predict future. In order to predict, you need more data, because otherwise someone else would take an edge over you. So in order to, for example, if you want to predict changing consumer trend, you need to have data from reviews, search logs and all that. If you want to predict change in climate, you need to have IoT data. Three main sources of alternative data are individual, businesses and sensors. This is where individuals create data, this is where business processes, and this is where sensors. Satellite, geolocation, Internet of Things, other sensors, transaction, corporate data, social media, news reviews, web searches, personal data. And then there are millions and billions of data points. So this is how data is being created and this is a big data. So why is it a challenge? Its quality is a challenge. So you have so much of data, you do not know which one is useful and which one is not. You may select only that data which is not useful. You may end up missing some data, or you may end up selecting some data which is not required. So quality problem, volume, you may select and so you may not have sufficient data. So there is so much of data being created, you might not be able to get all of that data. So volume is a problem. Appropriateness, not well suited for the analysis. Maybe you are not able to analyze that data. It is in such a form that you cannot analyze it. So that means data needs to be sourced, cleansed and organized. It will only be useful if it is cleansed, sourced and organized. Unstructured data is mostly qualitative and difficult to organize or quantify. So that means there needs to be some other means of analyzing that data as well, because that is again some data and should be used. So now the question is that how do we deal with these challenges or this massive amount of data? It is humanly impossible to deal with it. So we have artificial intelligence and machine learning coming in to analyze that data or to deal with that data. So any problem so far? So moving on to artificial intelligence and machine learning. So what is artificial intelligence? It has enabled computers to exhibit cognitive and decision making ability. So previously computers used to take instructions from humans and then perform a task. But now they have become smart enough to take instructions from themselves or think like humans. So that is known as artificial intelligence. There are two types of systems, expert and neural. So for example, if there is a system which is expert in doing something or accomplishing a task, based on if then rules, that if this happens, do this, if that happens, do this, that is expert system. If there is a system which thinks like human brains or which has a programming based on how human brain learns and it learns itself like human brain learns, then that is known as neural network. That is, it will process the information just like human brain and it will keep on learning just like human learn. Here it will be some learning which you have already fed into it. That is, you have, for example, 100,000 or 1 lakh or 10 million instructions, and based on if then rules it can perform a task. Here it will learn itself and improve with experience. With every experience it will improve itself. Machine learning programs that are able to learn how to perform a task and improve their performance over time. So this improvement in performance over time is known as machine learning. These programs require massive amounts of data for training. Growth in big data is helping improve modeling and predictive accuracy of ML programs. So machine learning requires huge amounts of data. And where is that data coming from? Big data. So as we have more and more big data coming in, that is actually enabling machines to learn more or at a faster pace. So that is actually supporting the machine learning, and machine learning with big data is now becoming more and more efficient and predictive. So in machine learning, computer algorithm gives inputs and maybe outputs. So previously what used to happen is that humans used to give inputs and machines used to give outputs. Now machine is capable of taking inputs itself as well. So computer algorithm is taking inputs itself. So there are two types of machine learning, one in which you give input and other in which it takes input itself, that we will discuss shortly. But anyhow, there is an input and based on that there is an output. If model inputs and target data set too precisely, it might get overtrained and start overfitting. So there are two different concepts, underfitting and overfitting. So let's say that you have so much of data that machine is going into so much of precise or smaller pieces of information that it may end up finding out a trend which does not exist or which is not, and based on that it may make inaccurate prediction. That is known as overfitting. Or on the other hand, maybe it is structured in such a way that it only look at the broader trend and might miss out on some smaller pieces of information, which is underfitting. So overfitting is when noise in data, noise is any data which is irrelevant or which does not a reason for pattern. So overfitting is when noise is included, and underfitting is when in order to exclude noise, you actually exclude some valid variables as well. So there can be a problem of overfitting and underfitting. So therefore it can appear to be a black box which arrive at outcomes that are not entirely understood or explainable. So if there is underfitting or overfitting, it can arrive at something which is unexplainable. Types of machine learning. So as I told you that there can be a machine learning in which you tell the machine inputs and then it gives you outputs. That is known as supervised learning, in which you are supervising the machine. It is doing everything itself, but you are a supervisor, you are supervising it. For example, predicting whether the stock market performance will go up, down or flat. So you have told what you want to predict, and then machine will predict if it will go up, down or flat. You have told what to do. There is unsupervised learning as well, in which machine can itself find out the input. So for example, here you will tell the machine that these are the correlations, or you can tell that these are the variables A, B, C and D. Based on that, find out whether market will go up or down, and then it can draw a correlation how much is correlated with A, B and C. Here you do not tell the inputs or A, B, C, D. Machine itself find that out. So for example, you give machine 100 securities and you say divide them into different buckets or different groups. Perform the grouping of these securities. You haven't told them that, told machine that industry is a variable. You haven't told machine that growth can be a variable. But you have asked machine to divide itself. Now machine itself will find out that how can they be grouped, and then divide them and make different groups. Based on, so it will itself find out that what is the relevant factor for making the group. Is it industry? Is it correlation? Is it industry? Is it price to earning? Is it what? So itself it will find out. So it may end up telling you that A, B and C are similar, while maybe you thought that these three are different industries, so they are not similar. But still, in being different industries, maybe they are similar. Maybe they behave in same way due to some reasons. So that is the unsupervised learning, in which machine itself can supervise itself. And example can be grouping companies based on characteristics. And then deep learnings, in which computers use neural networks to perform multi-stage non-linear data processing to identify pattern. It is related to neural network, that is thinking like human or learning like human. It can be supervised or unsupervised. Moving on, data science. What is data science? It is the science of analyzing the big data. That is data science. That how do you analyze big data? That is data science. How do you process data? Data processing methods include capture, curation, storage, search, transfer. Remember all these terminologies and their definitions. This is important. Capture, how is data being captured? Is it in real time? Is it not in real time? Is it low volume? Is it high volume? Curation, ensuring quality and accuracy through data cleaning, only taking the good data and removing the bad data. Storage, how should data be recorded, achieved, archived and accessed. Search, once you have stored it, how should you access it? How should you search for it? Transfer, how will data move from storage location to analytical tool? This is all what is known as data science. That is using the big data. How do you use it? You capture, you curate, you store, you search, and you transfer. In these five steps, you make use of big data, and this is known as data science or data processing methods. So within data science, once you have processed the data, then you need to show data, you need to show result. So how do you visualize it? There can be different ways of visualizing, which include multi-dimensional data analysis, that is using color, shapes, sizes and 3D art. Another way is tag cloud, that is words are sized and displayed based on frequency in data file. So this is a word cloud, this is a tag cloud. If you look into it, you know that this is the most important variable than this. So looking at the picture, you know which are the important variables, which are not so important variable. So based on size and display of words, you are able to analyze the overall data. If these are different reasons, different variables, you would know which variable is moving and which variable is not moving. This is tag cloud. Or you can have mind map, that is display frequency of words and show how different concepts are related. So these are some tools being used in data sciences in order to visualize data, in order to make it more readable or more understandable in graphical form or in with a better display. Otherwise, it will be difficult to analyze or make sense of the large amounts of data. Selected applications of fintech to investment management. Where is it being applied? It is being applied in tax analytics, natural language processing, robo advisory, risk analysis, and algorithmic trading. What is tax analytics and natural language processing? It is analyzing and driving meaning from large unstructured text or voice dataset. So let's say you have large amount of text in terms of blogs, reviews, whatever. So bringing out the usable data from that, or making use of that large amount of data, or analyze that large amount of data, or let's say you have voice data sets, you have voice notes and all that. So making use of that or extracting data from that is known as tax analytics. It can help identify consumer sentiment. Then natural language processing, that is the intersection of computer science, AI and linguistics. That is, you analyze and interpret human language through translation, speech recognition, text mining. It can help analyze nuances within text or communication and raise flags. So if a text is changing, if let's say comments from consumers are changing, if communication is changing, it can raise the red flag that something is changing, something is wrong. So this is how it is, that based on the tags, blogs, reviews, comments, voice notes and all that, these tools can help you analyze the movements in the sentiment or market. Robo advisory services that we just discussed provide investment solutions regulated by SEC in US. It starts with questionnaire, takes historical information and clients' investment parameters, and then execute. Low fee and low account minimums. Two types of services, either fully automated or advisor assisted. In fully automated, there is no advisor at all. In advisor assisted, there is a virtual advisor. There is a virtual advisor which can help advise. Criticisms, human expertise is required in times of crisis. May not always provide a rationale for a particular recommendation. It may recommend but not provide a rationale that why is it recommending it. There can be trust issues. These all are criticism, but kaise matlab? So just like investment managers, just like SEC would keep a track of investment managers, that what are the how are they operating, what are they trading, what are they buying, what are they selling, they would also keep a track of robo advisor systems or robo advisory services, that what is being bought, what is being sold, what is how are they behaving, how much market risk, how much risk are they adding to market. They are to ensure that they are not front running, they are not manipulating market and so on. Another application is risk analysis. So big data provides insights into real time and changing market circumstances. Machine learning can help predict failure of a company. AI facilitates what if scenario analysis and back testing simulation. Algorithmic trading is another example or application. Computerized buying and selling of financial instruments. So you set up the algorithm, based on that algorithm, computer will itself buy and sell and trade the asset. High frequency trading, make use of vast quantities of granular financial data to automatically place trades when certain conditions are met. And they execute trade on ultra high speed, low latency networks in fractions of a second. So it can trade even in a fraction of a second. So let's say if a particular condition is met, for example, you have a condition that if volume goes up to this level, and if orders go up to this level, and if price goes up to this level, buy. So even if that happens in a fraction of a second, it can immediately execute the trade instead of missing the opportunity. But then again, risk is if somewhere it goes wrong, then it will be difficult to stop losses. So we discussed three main components: big data, AI and machine learning. And we said that AI and machine learning are actually helping deal with big data, and big data is actually enabling to improve machine learning and AI. Then we discussed another concept that we discussed at the start, was that fintech is also impacting the ownership transfer of assets, and they are tracking through blockchains and distributive Distributive Ledger Technologies, DLTs. So this we have discussed. Now we are on blockchain and DLTs. What is DLT? It create, exchange and track ownership of financial assets, like that example we did from farmer to consumer. So everything, all the ownership can be tracked. Benefit: accuracy, transparency, scrutiny, faster ownership, transfer, peer-to-peer interaction. Like one of the examples can be cryptocurrencies. Cryptography. What is cryptography? An algorithmic process to encrypt data, making it unusable by unauthorized parties. So data will be encrypted to flow throughout the network, and that encrypted data will be unusable by unauthorized parties. Only the authorized ones can use it. Smart contracts. So distribute, one of the key feature of DLT is a smart contract. What is a smart contract? They are programs which self execute on basis of pre-specified condition, that if a condition is met, it is executed. So for example, if this happens, then pay X amount from one to another. If this happens, pay X amount from one to one party to another. Consensus mechanism. So computer entities, nodes in a network agree on common state of ledger. So each node, each of these participants will agree on one ledger, one database, and this will be visible to everyone. So everyone will be aligned with what is happening. All the parties will be on the same page. It includes two steps: transaction validation and agreement on ledger update by network parties. So whenever a transaction is being executed, a sale is being done or a purchase is being done, that transaction is first validated, and then there needs to be an agreement on ledger. That is, other party should agree that it has happened. Whenever these two happens, then it becomes a part of ledger and is executed, otherwise not. So that means there needs to be an agreement and there needs to be a validation. So that means whatever comes on the ledger or whatever is executed, that is executed after agreement and validation, and so there is, that is accurate. So you have different data sets, different, and all those different data sets or the information from multiple data sets can be combined into one database, and then everyone can have a visibility of that database, and based on this the transactions can be executed. Blockchain is a type of distributed ledger in which information is linked within blocks, which are chained together and secured using cryptographic methods. The process to update blockchain can require substantial amounts of computer power, making it extremely expensive for an individual third party to manipulate historical data. To manipulate historical data, an individual would have to control majority of the nodes in the network. So someone cannot manipulate or change the data until and unless it has control over majority of the nodes, and that is not possible. That's why it is more very secure. Permissioned and permissionless networks. Permissionless networks are open to any user who wishes to make a transaction. It does not depend on centralized authority to confirm or deny. For example, Bitcoin. Anyone can buy, anyone can sell. Applications of DLT in investment management. Cryptocurrencies are an example. Initial coin offering, which is alternative to IPO, that instead of issuing shares, you issue cryptocurrencies, crypto tokens to raise capital. Tokenization, representing ownership rights to physical assets on a blockchain or DLT. Post-trade clearing and settlement and compliance. These all are applications of DLT in investment management. What are the challenges? Challenges is lack of DLT network standardization. There are different networks and standardized networks are lacking. Processing capabilities may not be financially competitive. What does it mean? It means they are very expensive, and due to that may not be used very often. Increasing the scale of DLT system requires substantial storage resources, because there is so much amount of data to be stored. So substantial storage resources are required. Immutability of transaction. Accidental or canceled trades can only be undone with offsetting trade. Once something is done, it cannot be undone. It can only be undone by an opposite trade. So for example, if A has sold something to B, he has sold it. It cannot be undone. It can only be undone with B selling it to A again. So there will be another transaction required to undo something. Requires huge amounts of computer power with high electricity usage. Regulatory approaches may differ by jurisdiction. So these are all challenges to DLT or blockchain. But anyway, this is the use of technology is increasing at a very high pace. Any problem?